It is showtime.
The broadcast is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Six and two is eight.
Good morning, everybody. This is Sweet Home Chicago. We are back in Chicago. This is Dr. Minarcik, and it's February 19th, Tuesday, and it's 9 o'clock here in Chicago. And I am very, very glad that many of you, hopefully all of you, remembered one way or another that this is a major time change for most of you. So this is 3 hours, later than you usually started, because we started at 8 o'clock in Puerto Rico, which is 2 hours ahead of us, and now we're 9 o'clock in Chicago. So this is a 3 hour time change. This is our 44th session of Global Online Medical School Pathology. And the first song was very appropriate. It was by the Blues Brothers. Welcome back from Chicago. The only unwelcome thing is that the lowest temperature that I experienced on my body in Puerto Rico was 65 degrees. It was 6 degrees when I came home, and it's about 12 degrees right now if you want to look up Lake Bluff. Maybe it's gotten a little warmer in the last minute or so. Might as well start by doing our test. The first test question is, can you hear me? And I hope to get a whole string of yeses. I don't hear any yeses. Hold on. That's because I don't have the window slide down. Yeah, okay, good. Second question is, what do you see on your screen? Okay, everybody got that one right too. And the third question is, did you hear the music well? Okay, in fact, I'll make it one step further. Was the music today better than anything that you ever heard in Puerto Rico? That's what I thought, because I have my studio set up here on my third floor in Lake Bluff to be very, very good for music as well. In fact, as one more audio-visual test, this is the most critical question. When we were playing the song at the beginning and at the end, was this little box that you see here moving in time to the music according to the way you saw it? In other words, boom, boom, boom. Okay, good. That's like excellent resolution for all of us. I guess we could start talking about what we're going to do today now. What we're going to do is finish up on the labs that we neglected when we were in Puerto Rico. If you remember, we did not have a skin lab in Puerto Rico. We did not have a CNS lab. We did not have a musculoskeletal histopathology lab. So the last session, which was the session we had from Caguas, Puerto Rico, without the iguanas, we did a whole bunch of lab cases. And we still have a good number of central nervous system cases left. And we have all the musculoskeletal. Specifically, I'm going to pop open our window in terms of what we're going to do today. As you could see, these are the cases we have for musculoskeletal. The thumbnails just popped up so you could actually see the glass slides. And we're also going to finish off some cases here with central nervous system too. Now, I hope that the computer is fast enough. I was using a very fast computer in Puerto Rico, and the one I have here at home now, it works, but it reminds me of, I feel like I'm Han Solo in the Millennium Falcon. I have to kick the thing every morning to get it going, but once it's going, it's super fast. Okay, well, it's still warming up, I guess. Couple of small announcements before we go to lab. I don't think that we're going to have a long day today. It's very possible that we are going to have a little bit of a shorter day. So I mentioned it in Facebook, and I would also recommend that if you buzzards out there, please, if you would like to say a few words about anything, especially perhaps how it was like in Puerto Rico compared to Chicago, I would really appreciate that. What I discovered, the big, big, big dazzling results that I discovered from Puerto Rico, is that when we did the synchronized medical school auditorium online broadcast, first of all, I was really, really nervous that it wouldn't work. But it worked great. But was even more spectacular is that it went a lot better than I thought, because the iguanas learned from you, and you're the buzzards, because every time I asked them a question, they would look up at the screen to see what the buzzards had to say first, just to verify their own thoughts. And also, I think that a lot of you buzzards, especially those that are not from American medical schools, appreciated learning in the same room as a really good American medical school. So that was the big thing. Now, I don't know. I would have to ask a question at this point. Did you buzzards in any way feel neglected because I had to focus my attention more on the warm bodies in front of me? Well, I see one no. I see three no's in a row, and that's good enough for me. I see everyone. Okay, good, because I felt that way. But I have a whole page full of no's, so I'm very, very happy to know that. Okay, let me ask you this. Did you prefer learning with the iguanas rather than just being by yourself? The answer would be yes, no, or no matter. And I see mostly yeses. Oh my God, maybe I'll have to go back to Puerto Rico. Seeing as how there's a big weather difference, I had a hard time leaving there. Okay, next item, we will talk about what we're going to do. We finished the entire semester in Puerto Rico. When we finished the discussion on central nervous system, that was the end of their systemic pathology year. Now, we did, with a couple of exceptions, their entire systemic pathology year. We came a little bit late. So the part that we didn't do for systemic pathology was blood vessels, heart, lung, and blood cells. Those are the four topics that we did not do, but we're going to continue to do them here under systemic pathology. We also did not finish a couple of topics in general pathology when we went to Puerto Rico. We did not do the 9th chapter on environment nutrition, and we did not do the 10th chapter in peds. So we have about 5, 6, 7 chapters left to finish this course up. Now, at the rate of, 2 sessions a week, you know, at 9 o'clock from Chicago, which was our usual habit, we probably are going to be going for at least a couple of more months. I suspect we are going to probably end up somewhere in the middle of May, which is what we did last year in 75 sessions. Now, we're on number 44 right now, so we still have 2 or 3 months left to go. Okay, now, I'll tell you what, because you're my students and you have your preferences, I'm going to give you the choice. Should we continue with the discussion on systemic pathology, in other words, blood vessel, heart, lung, red blood cell, white blood cell, or should we finish up the 2 chapters on general pathology first? That is my question. General or systemic? Which should we do first? Ooh, I'm seeing kind of a split audience here. I'm seeing really it's going right down the middle. Okay, well, you want to know something? I see a little bit more systemics than general. So here's what we'll do. After we finish our lab today, we will then finish the discussion with systemic. We'll do blood vessels, and then we'll do heart, and then we'll do lung, and then we'll do red blood cells, and then we'll do white blood cells. Those are the 5 topics. And that'll take us a couple of months. And then at the end of the systemic pathology topics, we'll throw in those last 2 relatively short but interesting topics in general pathology, environment and nutrition. So we'll finish off on systemic and then do the much shorter topics in general. How does that sound? Are you happy, buzzards? Okay, and by the way, just out of curiosity, I don't suspect there's any iguanas here today that turned into buzzards, because I know you have a big neuro exam coming up, and this does not really going to help your exam. And usually, you know, the medical students get freaked out when the exams are near and they wind up, you know, cutting all their classes. And I don't blame them, because I did it too. Okay, are we ready to go to the pathology laboratory?
Yes, we are.
So, I guess we could say, here is the second floor of the laboratory. Here is the door that is labeled central nervous system. We'll walk into the door. We could see that even though we did a couple of these already, I think it's important to do them again, simply because they're so important to emphasize. And most of these we have not done already. So we'll finish up in the first hour our discussion on central nervous system tumors. And then we'll enter the door that's called soft tissue, joint, and bone, which is a few more slides in the second hour. So the reason why I wanted to repeat a couple of the central nervous system slides is to show you an interesting phenomenon, because you know the students have been asking me about correlations between the pathology and the radiology. For example, one student asked me yesterday online, do metastases from cancers to the brain all look the same, or are they all different? And I'm going to show you something interesting. I'm going to show you what we saw before. This is a brain abscess. You might even remember it just from looking at the thumbnail. But you could see in this slide, which you have against your white lab coat now, that there's something blue and irregular in the middle. And then there's something a little bit pinker towards the periphery. So we've already seen this and described it, and we know that this is generally where I'm riding along through the southern coast of Puerto Rico here. This is the edge of the abscess. This is relatively normal brain here in the southeast. And in the interface, you could see blood vessels and fibroblasts. This might wind up being kind of a capsule which will wall off this abscess. Now, do you notice that when you travel towards the inside of the abscess, like here, it turns into water? In other words, liquefactive necrosis. Now, do you understand why the radiologists on CT will talk about the ring sign? Because it has the denser tissue at the periphery and the more less dense watery tissue on the inside. Now, that's on CT. Now on MRI, when you can enhance proton or water signals, this part here where the water is will be very, very bright compared to the more tissuey area, which has less water and less protons. So now, this is a regular brain abscess, okay? Now check this out. I'm going to show you something else right next to it. We saw this one the other day too. This is a high-grade glioma. This is a glioma multiforme. Remember we said that there's necrosis, and we saw that all of this area here in the center is necrosis. It's not normal brain, because I'm going to blow it up now. And you're going to see two major things that are so characteristic. You see that this big central area is necrotic, and you can see that a lot of the tumor cells are palisaded over here. And in addition, I'm going to throw up just a little corner here so you can see some of these cells. Now, are these cells from hell or not? Are they big and nasty? Those are like three classical features of a GBM. Of course, the fourth one we might not be able to see too well right now. It's basically a vascular growth pattern. Now, let's go back to the interface between the edge of the tumor and the central abscess area. This is necrotic. You don't see any nuclei here. It may very well start to liquefy. It's less dense than the tumor. It has more necrosis than the tumor. It has more water than the tumor. Now here's the question. Do you understand now, right? Radiologists have a hard time differentiating abscesses from centrally necrotic tumors because the CT and the MRI signals could be identical. Okay, now here's the answer to the student's question. He said if somebody had a metastasis to the brain from another cancer, would they all look different or would they all look the same? And think about the histology. A metastatic tumor can be calcified, it can be liquefied, it can be necrotic, it could be dense. So the answer is, it would all look different, wouldn't it? No matter whether you did CT or MRI, the only thing that would help you differentiate metastatic disease from primary diseases like GBMs or abscesses is the number of lesions. So a person with 5, 6, 7 widely scattered lesions in the brain is absolutely going to be a metastasis. Now, a primary malignant glioma like this can have satellite lesions, but they are not going to be widely distributed throughout the brain. And of course, the last question, I'm going to give this to all of you. I've said it about 6 times already. It's very important. Do even the worst brain tumors usually metastasize outside the brain? And you all got that one right, too. Okay, that's clarifying one thing. Let's go back to this one here. We did it again, but I'm going to say it again. Remember, the last slide we saw was a high-grade astrocytoma. It had necrosis. It had palisading. It had extremely bizarre nuclei. Now look, I'm going to show you another astrocytoma, which this is. And I'm going to ask you 3 things. Do you see necrosis? Yes or no? No, is correct. Do you see, do you see really bizarre, horrible looking astrocytes, or do you just see some that are like moderately to mildly atypical? So not, I would say that's atypical. In fact, if you were in the point of looking at this in the pathology lab and you had to decide whether it was just a nonspecific gliotic reaction to some injury or whether it was a true glioma, you would probably go in the direction of glioma simply because of a cell like this and a cell like this and a cell like this. Usually gliosis in itself, and there's another one, does not have much atypia. So this is a moderate or maybe perhaps even low-grade glioma, maybe a 1 or a 2, whereas the high-grade gliomas are generally 3s and 4s. Okay, so now we'll go on to another thing which we saw, but I can't emphasize it enough. It's probably the only thing about the brain I remembered from medical school before I got into pathology. This is another brain. And I'm hoping it'll be a knee-jerk reflex with you. You could see that there's a blood vessel, and there's a lot of glial cells, and the cells here with the halo are the oligos. And maybe we could see a few neurons. I don't know. That might be one. But for the most part, this is white matter with glial cells. Okay. Somebody got it already. They probably have a good memory. You could see that, for example, in this blood vessel, there might be a few increased and scattered cells around the blood vessels, maybe not very much, but I'm going to show you another area now. I'm going to show you, for example, here, this blood vessel. So what is your knee-jerk reflex for lymphocytic infiltrates surrounding blood vessels in the brain? You all know this is probably a classic textbook picture of an encephalitis. And probably what kind of encephalitis? You're all saying encephalitis. So you know that this absolutely screams of virus. Okay, good. That didn't take much time because we saw that one already. And I'm going to take 6 seconds again because it's so important. You've seen this one, and maybe we should have done this at the beginning. But look at this beautiful, normal brain. So, for example, if you were to write out a template, which we have done, for normal brain, you would probably start out by saying something like, oh, the leptomeninges are smooth and glistening. Actually, I'm kind of worried about this. When I see some increase in cells, I'm wondering if this might be an early meningitis. But let's ignore the meninges. This was submitted as normal brain. But the thing to remember, this is the cortex. You can see that we're looking at the peripheral part of gray matter, a gyrus. And you can see a lot of these bigger, more triangular cells, like there and there, are the neurons, and there. And most of these cells, especially the ones you see with the halos, and there's a bunch of them here, you know those are oligos. Most of these are oligos. Now, a cell that does not have a halo, but it's relatively small, like this, or perhaps this, or perhaps this, that would probably be suspected as either an astrocyte, or if it's even smaller, a so-called microglia. So just keep that in mind as in your memory banks for like totally normal brain, and then all the stuff you see after that will be variations from that normal. Okay, here's a new case. You could probably see the title of it, but I don't want you to, you know, go shouting out the answer simply because you see it. Actually, I probably would, you know. What we see here again is brain. And do you notice how, like, in the southeast, the brain looked kind of like normal density, normal cellularity, and I also mean, you know, CT density as well. And then as you move towards the center, it looks like it's taking on more and more edema or water. And then finally, you have something that's like what we call LQ, liquefactive necrosis. So let's go to the relatively normal part, which is down here. And it's looking very much like that normal brain. You can see a lot of oligos. You can see a blood vessel here and here and here and here. Oh, I don't know. I'm having a hard time finding some good neurons in here, but this may not be an area of nucleus where there's a lot of neurons. So let's take our hand and drag it now from the denser area. And could you see? It's already becoming a little bit more waterified, more proton signals. And look, what do we have here? Oh, this is a really, really, really good example. If I tell you that this is relatively normal brain down here in the southwest, then what do you call all of this stuff in the northeast? This is the world's best perfect example of gliosis. Absolutely. So really, what's the difference between the southwest and the northeast? It's gliosis. There's more of these glial cells. And look, they're not oligos because most of them do not have halos around them. So what kind of glial cells do you think these are? I'll give you five choices. I'll name all the glial cells, and you tell me what you think most of these are. Astrocytes, oligos, micros, ependymos, or Schwann cells. Yeah, they're microglia. These are the so-called macrophages of the central nervous system. These are the ones that are doing the job of macrophages, even though they are microglia. Do you also see the increased water as well? Okay, let's continue to go now into an area that's probably more gliotic and more edematous. Now, what is the number one thing I told you about 12 times during the lecture and during the lab? What are the three things that you always see as a non-specific response to brain injury, no matter what the cause is? We see gliosis, we see edema, And what was the third thing? Come on. Do you see a relative lack of oligos in this picture? Yeah, demyelination, isn't it? This is the great example of what I keep telling you. Okay, so let's keep going. It'll probably get even worse. Well, I guess when you get into the liquefactive necrosis area, you won't see any cells at all, will you? You won't see any nuclei at all, will you? Oh, I bet we're getting there, because I know we're going there. I know we're going in the right direction. Oh, I also know, for example, when I pan the image rather than just zoom in on the image, it takes you a couple seconds longer to see it. For example, what I'm going to do right now is just click on this image so it looks a little bit smaller. And I'm going to ask you, as soon as I click, when do you see the smaller image? Just say now, as soon as you see that it got smaller. Okay, well, I'm seeing between 2 and 3 seconds for an average response. However, when I drag the image, I'm going to ask you, when do you see the screen fill up again? Whoops, sorry. Oops, I didn't want to do that. Now let's try this again, because we're about in here. And now I'm going to ask you, when I drag the image, tell me, when do you see the screen fill up again? I'm going to drag it right now. Oh, well, it's a little bit longer. Yeah, it is. It's rather like 4 or 5 seconds. So that's why I've learned not to pan the images in the path lab. It's better to just zoom in on them. But you're still seeing gliosis, edema, and we don't have a myelin stain, but you see a lot fewer oligos. So you could guess this is also demyelinated as well. And finally, we are at the coastline, and now we are in the sea of liquefactive necrosis. Now, there still may be a few little necrotic, partially necrotic cells, but you know this is all liquefactive necrosis. There's some proteinaceous material, but basically, there's about 8 times more water here than you see over here. So that would mean, number one, decreased density on CT and increased signals on T2-weighted images, MRI. Okay, so now we see a part of the brain that looks like it's dead, it's necrotic, we don't see tumor cells. So what is without a doubt the most overwhelmingly common cause of dead brain? Yeah, you're all saying the same thing. You're saying thrombus, you're saying embolism, you're saying infarction, you're saying hypoxia, you're saying ischemia. It all saying stroke. You're all saying CVA, aren't you? Okay, good. That means I don't really have to show much of this slide anymore. I did want to show you one more thing. As long as we got very good resolution on this case, I want to show you, oh yeah, probably these cells over here. Okay, good, good, good. What do you think most of these cells are? Before you answer, especially if you don't really know for sure, let me ask you this. If we were in an atherosclerotic plaque, and I told you those were foamy macrophages, would you believe me? If we were in a xanthoma of the skin, and I told you those were foamy macrophages, would you believe me? I'll say, whatever these cells are, they have the capacity for phagocytosis of, let's say the best word is junk, perhaps dead brain. So they have macrophagic properties. So what are these cells most likely? You call them macrophage generically, or you call them microglia specifically. These are the types of glial cells that have macrophagic properties. Okay, we're done with this case. It was a good case, classical stroke. I want you to remember also that a classical infarct or stroke of the brain is very, very similar to a classical stroke, or let's say infarct of the myocardium, in that at the beginning you just may see loss of nuclei. Remember the red nuclei. As that goes on, you may see infiltration by either glial cells or even neutrophils. And then as time goes on, you can actually see, you know, dead brain, which of course necrosis in the brain is liquid, whereas necrosis in the myocardium is probably coagulative necrosis. Now, the heart infarct may heal with a scar. Do you think that the brain infarcts heal with a scar, or do you think they just kind of remain liquefied? You're absolutely right. Okay, we're done for sure now. And well, now we'll take those four last cases. Okay, I know you could see the little thing, but please put that out of your mind. Don't prejudice yourself, because I want to show you something really cool on this case. This is another tumor inside the cranium. You notice I said inside the cranium rather than of the brain. And the first thing you'll notice about this tumor, before you blow up the slide, is that it's very, very vascular. Look at blood vessel, blood vessel, blood vessel, blood vessel, blood vessel, blood vessel. I can tell you that when they do angiography on these tumors, they often look like they are AVMs because they are so immensely vascular. And you can see all these vascular spaces already. Another thing that you can probably imagine that in some of these tumors, let me show you this area here. I'm going to zip up here in Montana. And what is that, calcium or non-calcium? Is that calcium or non-calcium? Is that calcium or non-calcium? Is that calcium or non-calcium? So if you did a CT on this brain, you think you might see a lot of little, what they call stippled calcifications, little dots all over the place, just like you're seeing on the slide. Yeah. Now, it might not look solidly calcified, but do you think that's the amount of calcium that we see in this tumor can possibly even be 10 or 20 or 50 times as much? So it might look like a solidly calcified tumor. It could be. This one has a little bit of calcium. So let me ask you another question, because we're going to blow it up even further now. I'm going to blow up Montana again. And that's definitely the calcified area. How would you describe these other cells that are in circles over here? What is the buzzword? It's a W word. What is the buzzword for the way these cells are arranged? Well, you got the right, you're all saying Samoma bodies. That's nice. But if you were to say that the cells in this group here are whorled, W-H-O-O-R-L-E-D, or I think sometimes it's spelled W-H-I-R-L-E-D. You have fibroblastic sort of looking cells that are whorled. There's a lot of connective tissue between them, and some of these little whorled bodies are calcified. This is your classical Samoma body. There is only one tumor, primary tumor of the brain, that has Samoma bodies. And you all know what it is. You know this is a meningioma. Now, is this Samoma body the same kind of Samoma body that we see with papillary cancers, like papillary cancer of the thyroid or the breast or the ovary or the lung or anywhere? Not really, because this is a calcified structure of fibroblastic sort of cells. Whereas the Samoma bodies of papillary adenocarcinomas are just dried up papillae, which have both epithelium as well as connective tissue. But they're still both called sammoma bodies, and they're still both calcified generally. Okay, just in a review now, do sammoma bodies often actually infiltrate into the brain itself, or do they just push the brain? Yes, you're correct. You're all saying push. And somebody also used the word dystrophic calcification. That's a great word because it is calcified because of local reasons, not because this patient has hypercalcemia. So that's dystrophic calcification. Okay, another question. I got my pointer now on some pink stuff. If you were to tell me what is the chemical, the specific chemical that this pink stuff is that I have my pointer on? Well, somebody said fibrin, but I don't really see much bleeding here. I think this is absolutely collagen. Somebody said amyloid. It could be because it's pink, but most likely this is collagen. Most likely the little pink material surrounding most of these whorls are collagen as well. Now remember something. The meningioma is a tumor of the dura mater. What is the dura mater? The dura mater is fibroblasts, isn't it? So I suspect that if we did a trichrome stain, most of these little pink bands would wind up being collagen. Okay, here's what we could do. Let's just move back now that we've zoomed in so quickly and get a better view of the vascularity of this tumor. Big blood vessel there, big blood vessel there, blood vessels in the middle of this fibrous stuff, blood vessel here, blood vessel. These are very, very, very vascular tumors. In fact, when we did nuclear medicine and we would do an angiogram, a nuclear medicine angiogram of these tumors, the general rule was if something lights up instantly inside the brain, an area, quicker than anything else, either it's an AVM, arteriovenous malformation, or it's a meningioma, because they behave so similarly. They're both so intensely vascularized. I'm going to pan over a little bit more. I'm going to zoom in two or three notches. I'm going to ask you to take your final view of these whorled nests of cells, and I'm going to reassure you that's just about what every meningioma in the world looks like. Okay, we're done with this case. I don't know if we did this case, maybe we didn't, but it's certainly about time we did it. Now, you know that this is a gyrus here. I'm sorry. And you know that these are sulci, okay? Here's a gyrus. Here's a gyrus. Oh, this is probably cerebral cortex, I think. Here's another gyrus. And you can see the meninges, you know, especially the leptomeninges, the vascular meninges, the pia mater extending all the way between these little gyri. So somebody's, a bunch of you are already giving me the diagnosis before I blew it up. But I'm going to ask you, I'm going to blow this area up and I'm going to just ask you one question. And the question is the pattern of inflammatories that you see here predominantly in the meninges or in the brain? Okay, now let me ask you this. I agree, this is predominantly a whopping inflammatory infiltrate in the meninges. The brain is relatively spared itself. But what if the meninges were so packed with these inflammatory cells, we don't know what they are yet, that they also inflamed or infiltrated the brain itself? Would you call that a meningitis, or would you call that a meningoencephalitis? Yeah, you got that one right. Now, let's take the opposite side of the coin. Let's say that you have brain here that is predominantly inflamed, but it extends into the meninges. Would you call that the same thing, an encephalomeningitis or a meningoencephalitis? Absolutely. But this is a case in which the meninges are primarily inflamed. And I'm going to ask you, as soon as I go on higher power, what are the inflammatory cells? What are 99% of the cells in these meninges? Yes, everybody knows it's PMNs, it's leukocytes, it's neutrophils, it's neutrophilic granulocytes. So this is an acute meningitis. What are the chances that this acute meningitis is caused by a bacteria rather than a virus? Yeah, somebody said 100%. I agree. Somebody said 90. Maybe that's more correct. So, for example, if this was a one-year-old baby that had an ear infection and now they have an meningitis, and you did a Gram stain. Here, I'm going to blow up these neutrophils even more. Here, let's put it this way. If this is a meningitis in a one-year-old kid, what's the name of the organism? Yeah, you got it right. It's H. flu. What if it's a newborn baby, you know, a neonate? Somebody said strep is always possible. Neonate, what about E. coli in neonates? You think that's a good one too? Yep, so you're all getting them right. What if it's what if that's the meninges of an elderly person? Give me a couple of bugs. Well, Neisseria could be elderly, but here, what if this was a meningitis that was part of an epidemic? Then give me the name of the bug. Probably Neisseria, right? What if this was a meningitis in an elderly person? Would a Listeria also be on the list? Strep is always possible, almost in any age group. Okay, I think we're all getting that one right. And by the way, when I said 90 or 100% of these cells are neutrophils, I lied. It looks like this one's probably a macrophage. Probably that one too. But for the most part, these are all neutrophils, aren't they? Okay. Pneumococcus. You all named the bacterias, which are could most likely be. This is a... I don't think I showed you this, but if I did, I'm going to show you again. Here's a section through a spinal cord. I know you recognize that instantly. Okay, there's the fissure. There are the connecting fibers. I guess if we look closely, maybe we could find a central canal here. But the reason why this doesn't look pink, why most of our slides look pink, is because this is a stain for myelin. And any stain for myelin has to be a stain that will accumulate in fat, because myelin is fat. So this could be osmic acid, or it's a stain in which the fat looks black. But we can see a very, very large area in here of the central nervous system that's defat or demyelinized. Somebody saw this one in Rock Lab. It's a great slide. So can I tell you something? In all honesty, I can't think of a single disease other than one that this could possibly be. Aha, somebody said disseminated sclerosis. And everybody else is saying MS. And of course, disseminated sclerosis is a variant of multiple sclerosis. So this is a classical and one of the most beautiful pictures you'll see of a large plaque in MS. Now remember, we said that the plaques in MS are areas of demyelination, but we said that the plaques in Alzheimer's disease are little fibers that are probably surrounding beta amyloid. So look at dark stuff, myelin, lack of dark stuff, demyelination. Okay, great, great thing. Now let's go to the last case under central nervous system that I know we didn't see. And I think you'll get it instantly, by the way, because we've all been looking at normal brains and we all know the five types of glial cells. So I think you're already suspecting that this is probably not inflammation. I know that you're thinking that this is probably some kind of tumor because these are not inflammatory looking cells. But can I ask you a question in all honesty? Let's say that I told you that 100% of these cells here are tumor cells. Oh, there's some blood vessels too. But if I told you that 100% of these primary brain tumor cells are tumor cells, what kind of glial cells do they look like? Do they all have halos around them, even though they're tumor cells? So what would you call this tumor? Yeah, this is a oligodendroglioma. It's a tumor of oligodendrocytes. Remember, we saw the tumors of astrocytes and the really bad malignant tumors of astrocytes, which we call GBM. But these all look like oligos, and I'm sure that these are still myelin, but they're not normal looking myelin cells. They look like they're big and irregular and crowded. I want to show you something else too. What do you think this is in the middle? What do you think this is? Oh, come on, it's pretty obvious. Yeah, this is calcium. I got a whole string of calciums now. So let's zoom out a little bit. You know, we always are tempted to zoom in right away and look at the cells. Sometimes we fail to see the forest for the trees. What I'm going to do now is start zooming backwards. Whoops, I don't know how we got that. What I'm going to do now is start zooming forwards from here. And I'm going to ask you, what are all those little dark, large, extremely blue-black thingies? Those are all calciums, aren't they? So do you think that if you had a primary brain tumor that was largely calcified, and it wasn't a meningioma, what do you think your first choice would be, even though this is not a common brain tumor? Yeah, it would be an oligo. In fact, you know what? What I actually did is I saved the PowerPoints here, and I'm going to show you something cool. I'm going to show you a CT of this oligo. It's going to be somewhere here near the end. Yeah, look at that. Look at all of the massively dense calcifications. You know that's more than just stippled. So the area that we just saw could be an area like this. Up here, it's almost solidly calcium. And you know that the oligos are associated with chromosome losses of either 1P or 19Q. You know that they are often in the frontal or temporal lobes, and they're usually your relatively younger patients, your age, you know, in the 20s to 40s. And it's only a couple percent of brain tumors. Okay, let's see if we could get out of here. Okay, we're back in lab, I think. Let's close this last case. And let's look at the watch now. It says 9:49. So we're going to take our 10-minute break. We're done with the portion of central nervous system. After the break, we'll be going into here. We could delete that now. The soft tissue joint bone. Probably look at about, 10 or 12 more slides, 15, something like that. And then we'll call catch-up lab adequate. We'll start out on Thursday with blood vessels. So I picked all the music today. You know, Sweet Home Chicago was the lead song. I got a lot of country and soft, beautiful music in the middle. So we will see you in 10 minutes, folks.
Go away. away from my window. Leave at your own chosen speed. I'm not the one you want, babe. I'm not the one you need. You say you're looking for someone who's never weak, but always strong. To protect you and defend you, whether you are right or wrong. Someone to open each and every door, but it ain't me, babe. No, 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 it ain't me, babe. It ain't me you're looking for, babe. Go lightly from the ledge, babe. Go lightly on the ground. I'm not the one you want, babe. I'll only let you down. You say you're looking for someone who'll promise never to part. Someone to close his eyes for you. Someone to close his heart. Someone to die for you and more. But it ain't me, babe. No, 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 it ain't me, babe. It ain't me you're looking for, babe. You say you're looking for someone to pick you up each time you fall. To gather flowers constantly and to come each time you call. And we'll love you for your life and nothing more. But it ain't me, babe. No, 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 it ain't me. It ain't me you're looking for, babe.
Ooh.
Beautiful, beautiful song. Roberta Flack's signature song, and one of the most beautiful I've ever heard. Welcome back. We had our 10-minute break. I feel a little more secure now because Woofy is up here. I convinced him to come up, and he decides he wants to roll around on the rug and scratch his back. I've also noticed that we do have a couple of iguanas here. We have Lisa Gual from Puerto Rico with us, morphed from a iguana into a buzzard. So I don't know what we should call the hybrid, but basically that's what we created in Puerto Rico. We created iguana, buzzard, hybrids. Okay, the only thought that I got during our break is that I really, really love labs. Partly is because I'm sort of lazy, and lab is something that I really don't have to prepare much for. I just have to make sure that the slides are in order, and I glance through them for 2 seconds, because these are things I've seen all my life, and I've seen them multiple times during the course here as well. Pathology, as I know it, is an endangered species, and the reason is most American medical schools have decided to do these so-called integrated curriculums, and even though they have something called anatomy and something called physiology, they kind of blend them in with systems. So it also, in the second year of medical school, everybody is crazy and insane about USMLE exams. So it's very, very likely that a lot of the classical pathology courses, which I teach, are kind of morphed into Kaplanoid board review sort of sessions. And, I think that statistically it's probably helps the students on the boards, but I will always teach nothing but pure pathology. I am a pathologist. I am not a first aid physician. Let's go back into lab And if you remember, we had only one area left, and it would be the chapter I call ortho, which was musculoskeletal, you know, during the iguanas session. And we have a bunch of slides here, and I think they're all pretty straightforward. And I guess we could just look at them in the order in which I put them on there. I guess it looks like it's alphabetical to me. So you know what the first one is called, but let's kind of keep that in the back of our mind. Let's not think this is a chondroma, because that was the tag on it. Let's think this is a chondroma because overall it's a tumor. It's a tumor of bone, and it's a tumor of bone that does not look blue. In fact, it's a tumor of bone that does not look red like bone. In fact, you don't see much of what you'd call any kind of bone tissue here. Instead, you have a tumor that is very, very largely bluish. And offhand, I think you all know from basic histology 101, this is a quick, instant, knee-jerk pattern reflex recollection of cartilage. This looks like almost like hyaline sort of cartilage. You could see cells inside of lacunae. You see an amazing amount of ground substance or extracellular material here, which you know is rich in hyaluronic acid and mucopolysaccharides. And in all honesty, when you look at these cells, I think you'll agree that they all look like chondrocytes inside of lacunae. I think you will also agree that they don't look all totally uniform. Some are bigger, some are darker. Here you have a couple of people living in the same house. So this would be a classical microscopic and visual description of a chondroma. Now, I think everybody knows that from our general algorithm that we use for all soft tissue tumors. But let me throw out a question at you, and this is one that's going to require intellectual honesty, which most pathologists don't have. If I told you this was a low-grade chondrosarcoma rather than a regular old chondroma, would you believe me? Okay, I would certainly believe me. And that's because, you know, this is not totally normal looking cartilage, but it is very close enough to real cartilage. This is a classical chondroma. Now, don't feel bad if you have a little insecurity that you can't differentiate a regular chondroma from a low-grade chondrosarcoma, because most pathologists can't. This is the kind of thing that would be sent out, you know, for histology. I can remember getting one, a tumor that looked a lot like this on a trachea of the cartilage, hyaline cartilage of a trachea, and I called it a chondrosarcoma, and it had all the characteristics, and then, you know, somebody else called it a regular chondroma, and it made me look like I was a bad doctor that made this person lose his, you know, larynx unnecessarily. And then somebody else called it a chondrosarcoma. So some of these can be pretty controversial. But if it looks a lot like normal cartilage, but it's a tumor of bone, it's a chondroma. Now, what if this came from the inside of the bone cavity rather than something along the articular cartilaginous cap or growth plate? It would then deserve the term enchondroma, and that's the only difference. Enchondroma is a chondroma. What would you call a syndrome if a person had many of these all throughout the skeletal system? You probably call it multiple enchondromatosis. Do you also remember another name for the syndrome that we discussed? Allier's disease? Sure you do, because I just told you again. There we go. Let's go to the next case. Okay, this is a nice one. I think you'll instantly recognize this as bone in 2 seconds. Now I know you can all see it. You know these are all bone spicules. You all know this is fat marrow between the spicules. You know that this is hematopoietic bone marrow between these spicules. And you know that even though it's hematopoietic bone marrows, it's still about 50% fat. You can see that. And up here, it's non-hematopoietic or 100% fat marrow. Okay, so what's wrong here? Well, we got spicules. It looks like some of these spicules look like they're being kind of chewed up. Up here they look pretty normal, maybe a little thinner than usual. But look, look at this little spicule here. It looks like there's something dissolving it or chewing it up. So let's look at this one. Now, I don't know how good your memory is from Histology 101, but I bet you when you took Histology 101, you probably had a hard time finding osteoclasts in normal bone. So let me ask you this. Are you having a hard time now? Or is that an osteoclast? Is that an osteoclast? Is that an osteoclast? Is that an osteoclast? It seems like every other cell is an osteoclast. And that's what is actually dissolving these spicules. There's an osteoclast. So this person got a whole bunch of these osteoclasts, and they're taking the calcium out of this bone here, and they're putting it back into the blood. What would be a normal physiologic hormone that would tell all these osteoclasts to get to work and start chewing up the bone? That's right. It's parathyroid hormone overactivity. Could this be an adenoma of the parathyroid, even though we're looking at bone? Could this be a hyperplasia of the parathyroid? Could this be a malignancy of the parathyroid? It probably could be, but how likely is it for a malignant parathyroid tumor to produce cells that are well differentiated enough to pour out the thyrocalcitonin? Not very likely. I mean, it's possible, but I've just never seen one, that's all. Okay, so there's another osteoclast, and there's another osteoclast, and there's another osteoclast. So these spicules are being chewed up. Two questions. Does anybody remember the long name of the guy that described the situation where hyperparathyroidism chews up all of these bony spicules? You remember the guy's name? I've only mentioned it one or twice. Maybe some of you out there could do a quick Google. This is called von Recklinghausen's disease of bone. Okay? But you want to know a better name for it? I'm going to tell you a better name for it, because I'm going to show you something right now. Do you see how these spicules now have little cysts inside the spicules? And they have fibrous tissue inside these cysts? What if I told you a better name for this would be osteitis fibrosis cystica, because of these little fibrous cysts inside the bone? Does anybody else want to tell me if this appeared like a tumor, these cystic chewing up of bone made the bone look wider like a tumor? What kind of tumor would it be? You know, name a color somewhere between black and white. Yeah, these are also called brown tumors in the extreme form as well. So, hyperparathyroidism of bone, osteofibrotis cystica, von Recklinghausen's diseases, brown tumors. They're all basically the same pathophysiologic process, aren't they? Okay. Is there anything else we want to show you? No, this is a really good slide right here. So let's call this one history and move on to something here. And I don't even remember what this was. All it has is a number. Okay. Well, folks, what is this tissue here in the northeast? What is this instant pattern recognition tissue here? What kind of connective tissue? Yeah, hyaline cartilage. Now, what is underneath the hyaline cartilage? What kind of connective tissue is this? Instantly. Instant pattern recognition. Good. Bone. Okay. Now, you can see in the bone marrow, it looks like there's a lot of fibrosis, you know, rather than fat or blood cells. Look at, here's some more bone here, here's some more bone here. It doesn't look like there's marrow or fat between these bony spicules, though. So I'm going to blow it up, and I'm going to ask you something. What the hell is this? What the hell is this? Does bone normally have any type of glandular tissue as part of it? No. So let's put it this way, fill in the blanks. Glandular structures inside of a bone is blank until proven otherwise. Yeah, it's mets. Do you think this is metastatic squamous cell carcinoma, metastatic adenocarcinoma, metastatic lymphoma, metastatic sarcoma, metastatic glioblastoma? Yeah, this is a metastatic adenocarcinoma. I think I put this picture in one of my YouTube things. I don't know if it's still there or not. But yeah, these are irregular, haphazard glands. And, you know, just from the growth pattern that this is normal, you know, any glandular structure in the bone is metastatic. And I want to show you one last thing here for those of you who still don't believe me. Look at the extreme pleomorphism of these nuclei of the glandular epithelial cells. So there's no doubt about that. This is a quick recognition. What if I told you that this was from the bone biopsy of an 80-year-old man that came in with multiple lesions all over his spine? What would be, without a doubt, the most likely primary? Yep, y'all got that one right. Prostate. Let's move on. What if I told you this was a woman in her 60s with multiple hot spots all over? You know it's breast, statistically. Okay, good. But technically, in all honesty, this could be any adenocarcinoma. This could be pancreas. This could be colon. This could be any primary tumor to the bone from any glandular organ. Could be salivary gland. Okay, here's another one. These are really nice bone tumors. I like this. Here's another thing that we talked about. And once again, number one, you instantly recognize bone. You instantly recognize some periosteum over the bone, some fat surrounding that. You can see in almost 80% of this cross-sectional area, you see spicules of bone, and you see fat as well as hematopoietic cells between the spicules. And I bet you, if you were really good, you could probably find some megakaryocytes. Now, this looks like a little bit less than 50-50. This one looks like it's maybe, you know, 30-70 or 20-80. But how do you know this is hematopoietic marrow? Well, you know it's hematopoietic marrow because the cells are all various sizes and shapes. And if I found a megakaryocyte dispersed here somewhere, then I could probably really convince you quickly. So let's find a megakaryocyte. Usually you see about one per high power field. So let's make me honest and find a nice big megakaryocyte. Well, I see a couple of candidates. This could be a smashed megakaryocyte, but that's not proof positive. Here we go. I think I could convince you this was a megakaryocyte over here. Do you agree? You got a histology exam, you got one cell that's kind of multilobulated and it looks like it's 8 times bigger than all the other cells. Okay, so you know I didn't show this to you to demonstrate normal bone marrow, did you? What we're going to do is ask ourselves the question, well, if this marrow generally is a little bit hypoplastic or hypocellular, then why are there areas here in the marrow that look like they're 100% cellular. And furthermore, even from this power, I think you'll agree that they all look like they're monotonous, like maybe they're the same kind of cell. So let's zoom it in. And my God, they all kind of do look like the same kind of cell. Oh God, that's a little bit too much of a zoom because you could see some pixelization, so I'll back up a notch or two. Yeah, that's a good one. Okay, folks, what are 100% of those cells? Yeah, they're all plasmacytes. Five of you answered, and all five of you got it correct. Now, some of them are classical-looking plasma cells, but some of them you probably had to look longer. Like in some of them, you could see sort of like the cartwheel nucleus here and little lip of cytoplasm off to the side. You don't see too many of the so-called, and there's another one, but once you look at them, you say, oh, well, there's a cell that has a clear zone right there in the lip of cytoplasm. So these are all plasma cells, but they don't look perfectly normal, but they are 100% plasma cells. So when you see a bone marrow that has an area of 100% plasma cells, what is the easy slam dunk diagnosis? And you don't even have to do any special stains. Yes, this is multiple myeloma. And you could probably call multiple myeloma a tumor of bone. It's one of the commonest tumors, malignant primary tumors of bone. And because plasma cells are normally indigenous to the marrow. Now, when they are normally, let's say, 1 or 2% of the marrow, you look at nice plasma cells and you don't get worried. When that percentage comes up to, you know, 10 or 20, you're thinking, oh my God, could this be a myeloma developing? And when plasma cells are more than 20% of the marrow cells, it's almost always multiple myeloma. Okay, final question. If these plasma cells generally look like normal plasma cells, if these malignant plasma cells generally look like normal plasma cells largely, do you think they might function like normal plasma cells too? Yeah, so if a plasma cell normally pours out immunoglobulins, you know, gamma A, gamma G, you know, all the different gammas, and now you have a bone marrow that has 10 or 100 times more plasma cells than it should, do you think this person may wind up having a massive increase in his gamma globulins on serum protein electrophoresis? And furthermore, if these cells are malignant and they come from a single clone, do you think this would be monoclonal gammopathy? Yeah. Okay, good. How many of you know who Batman is? Remember Batman? He basically has a cap and it has like two pointed ears on it. Well, normally, when you look at a serum protein electrophoresis, it has one spike, which is the albumin, and all the rest of them to the right are little bumps. But all the way on the gamma side, you can see another spike, which is often about as big as the albumin spike, and that's what I would call the Batman sign. I don't know if this has been written up anywhere, but it's what I would call it. Okay, so multiple myeloma, slam dunk, easy diagnosis. Let's go to the next bone disease. And we could see bone here instantly. I know you're getting this, but we don't really see too much marrow between the bone. Instead, we see sort of fibrous tissue between the bone. And also, can I ask you a question? Do you remember in all the other bones we saw, the spicules were basically sort of straight, maybe a little bit curved? But look at this. These are spicules that are kind of growing, you know, every which way, on like marbleizing almost. So we got a bone here in which you will agree the spicules are not growing in a nice orderly fashion. And I think you will also agree that, my God, we got tons and tons of osteoclasts again. There's one. So, and also, I think you'll agree, when you look at the edges of these spicules, there's an awful lot of osteoblasts too. So, we got a situation of bone in which there's increased osteoclasts and there's some reactive osteoblasts as well. And somebody said, pituitary tumor? Question mark. Somebody said calcinoma? Calcitonin? Question mark. Somebody said fibrous dysplasia? Question mark. Hold on. What do you call it when the osteoclasts go wild and then that's followed by a physiologic reaction of the osteoblasts going wild? Look at, you'll all agree there's increased osteoclasts here. There's one. Okay, but what else do we have? You'll also agree as a reaction to that. Here, take a look at this spicule down here. Look at, these are all osteoblasts. You never see that many. So you all know this is Paget's disease, right? And in addition, can I show you something else? Do you notice that the bone that is being laid down does not generally conform to the lamellar pattern of bone? Yeah, you can see some osteocytes in here. But do you see how normally there's a lamellar pattern of bone? If not, I'll go back to another case and I'll show you. In fact, I will go back to another case. Let's go back to the previous case. Or here, this was a nice one. Let's go back to this case here. And when we look at the spicules, I think you'll agree that there's sort of a parallel lamellar pattern. Do you see that? That's the type 1 collagen intermingled with the crystalline bone. It's almost like parallel, or what they call lamellar. Okay, it's nice and parallel. Even down here, they're generally parallel. But what are they like in this Paget's disease over here? Take a look at the bone collagen lines over here. Are they parallel or are they every which way? Yeah, that's another classical feature. It's also a diagnostic feature. This is pagetoid bone. Now, last question, or I'll give you two questions about Paget's. Number one, could a sarcoma develop from Paget's disease? Yes, okay. If it does, is it most likely a osteogenic sarcoma of an older person or a younger person? Yeah, it's an older person. The osteogenic sarcomas that you see in the knee of teenage boys, those are not pagetoid sarcomas. Okay, and finally, the final question is, if you were to do a bone scan, a radionuclide bone scan on this patient, would the entire bone be as hot as hell? Yes, is the correct answer. You're all getting that one. Simply because the bone scan is indicative of osteoblastic activity. So where you have a lot of osteoblastic activity, like Paget's disease, that's when you get the really, really hot bone scans. Okay, now we see the increased osteoclast. We saw the increased osteoblast. If this does not develop into a sarcoma, but progresses for many, many, many years, is the bone likely to become just densely sclerotic? That's the third phase of Paget's, isn't it? Okay, we're done with Paget's. Let's go to this guy over here. Let's look at some fun things now. Oh, this doesn't look like bone. It doesn't look like cartilage. It looks like it's nothing. It looks like there's a big hole here and then it's surrounded by something. Would you want to call this a cyst? Yep. And Next question is, does the cyst have an epithelial lining? Here, I'll blow up the edge of the cyst here. Or does it have not really epithelial lining? These look more like sort of spindly cells, like maybe synovial cells or fibroblastic looking cells or perhaps macrophage looking cells. This is a cyst of a synovium. Okay, so we have a synovial cyst, big deal. Where are the three parts of the body where you see synovium? You could just start rattling them off. Somebody said ganglion, but that's not fair. Somebody said wrist, somebody said joint, somebody said knee joint. How about the B word? Are you forgetting the B word? Okay, they also line bursa, they line the joint space, and they wrap around tendon sheaths as well. Now, if I told you this was a cyst of the synovium, and you don't see any bone here, and you know it's not a bursa, then it's probably a cyst of the synovium that covers the tendon sheath. And what do you call a synovial cyst of a tendon sheath? Whether it's, yeah, it's a ganglion. So this is the run-of-the-mill ganglion. It's very boring. You could probably have a few little inflammatory cells here, but here, I'm going to draw a box here, and I'm going to ask you, what are 100% of the cells before your eyeballs right now? Those are just fibroblasts, aren't they? Classical fibroblasts. If we did a trichrome stain, this would be as green as hell. But that's just the wall of the cyst. The actual internal lining of the cyst looks more like synovial cells. Remember, some of the synovial cells are fibroblastic in origin, and they secrete all of that substance that you have normally inside of the joint space. Remember, rich in mucopolysaccharides and hyaluron type compounds. And the other layer of cells are macrophages in origin, and they do what macrophages normally do. They chew things up. Okay, so this is a boring ganglion. Oh, no, last question. Let's say that this cyst was removed by a surgeon, you know, rather than, you know, hit with the book or sucked out with the needle. Let's say that this cyst was taken out by the surgeon and it went to the pathologist's lab and nobody busted open the cyst. What do you think this cyst would most likely be filled with? What kind of substance? I don't know if you've seen a ganglion before. They're all loaded with mucoid-like substance. Some of you are saying it. So that's why, rather than surgical removal, sometimes they just try to stick the needle into it and suck out that stuff. But you know that that's more likely to recur than a surgical removal. Okay, good. Next question is going to be from our next case. And, you could see that this looks like the classical joint. I think you could instantly recognize this as cartilage. I think you could recognize this as underlying bone. I think you can recognize this part underneath the cartilage as loss of bone, or perhaps just kind of a fibrous or cystic-like space. This is a disease you will all get. What is it? Ah, everybody's quiet. Can't be that hard. Yeah, this is osteoarthritis. This is a osteoarthritis, and what is the first thing that happens in osteoarthritis? Let's say this is a relatively normal cartilage thickness here, but look at, it's eroded down here, isn't it? It's thinned out over here. It's loss of the thickness of the articular cartilage. And secondary, you can have both loss of bone underneath as well as lipping of the bone. So as this bone gets compressed, it often gets deformed and it looks like it's a extra part of bone, which we don't see here. This is not an osteophyte. This is a subchondral cyst of osteoarthritis. Okay. I don't think we see the osteophyte here, so I, you know, but you basically, if I was to give a exam question, I would say something like, show me the area of this end of a bone which is the most diagnostic of osteoarthritis. So you would have to say loss of articular cartilage. So if that's relatively normal thickness there, look, it's thinned out to practically nothing over there. And that shows up radiologically too, doesn't it? It shows out as thin cartilaginous between joints, like especially in the knee or hip. Okay, let's go on to the next one. Oh, you're going to love this one. I just showed you, without a doubt, the most universally common type of arthritis. What's the second most common type of arthritis? Yep. What is this type of arthritis more common in, men or women? Okay. Is this inflammation caused by external pathogens or autoimmune process? Good. Last question. No, I'll have to have more questions. Is this basically a chronic pattern of inflammation or acute? And what you see here. Okay, chronic. Do you think that long-term this could wind up being fibrotic? Does long-standing chronic inflammation wind up in fibrosis? Okay, next question is, what part of the joint is this? Is this the articular cartilage? Is this the underlying bone? Or is this all synovium? Yep, it is. And let's see. What else do I want to say? Oh, what is the autoimmune problem? What are the antibodies against? It's an antibody against an antibody, isn't it? It's an antibody, a gamma M antibody, against the FC, or the crystallizable fragment of the gamma G. That's what the rheumatoid factor is. Okay, now this is the most important question. It might be easy, but it's the most important. Because rheumatoid arthritis is showing us a synovitis here, do you think rheumatoid arthritis should be regarded as a localized or joint autoimmune disease? Or would you scream at the top of your lungs that it's systemic? Absolutely. Don't ever make that mistake. Okay, we're done. I think we've already pointed out the fact that whereas the primary focus of early osteoarthritis is loss and thinning and degeneration of the articular cartilage, you know that the primary early signs of a rheumatoid arthritis is a chronic or sometimes even acute synovitis, but it could have the same effects. It could result in a degeneration of the bone. It could cause nodules. And if this was a synovium from a finger, possibly, which of the three joints of the finger would probably be most severely involved? PIP, DIP, or MP? Okay, you're all pretty smart today, so let's move on. I can't fool you. Here's another one. What's the third most common type of arthritis after rheumatoid and osteo? Yeah, everybody knows it's gout. Even if they don't know what this tissue is, they know gout is the third. So you got some kind of fibrous tissue here. You probably got some inflammatory cells. You got definitely some fibrous tissue down here. And then you got this sort of whitish stuff. So let me ask you a question. What is this whitish stuff? Look, at some of it looks like it's needle-shaped or crystalline. See that? Some of it is artifact. So yeah, that's your uric acid. Specifically, is it uric acid or monosodium urate? This is a tophus. It's deposited in the soft tissues surrounding a joint, especially the joints which classically get the poorest blood supply and are most susceptible to acidosis. And it's the low pH that triggers off the deposition of these monosodium urate crystals around the joint. And the foreign body giant cell reaction to these crystals, you see a foreign body giant cell there, a foreign body giant cell there, is called a tophus. This is a tophus of gout. Was this an easy case for you? Yeah, you probably all say yes. Okay, it was an easy case for me too. I don't know if I want to show this one. I might save that to the end. Here's another one. You can see this is largely pink here, and it looks like it's largely connective tissue. Oh, there's a little bit of fat down here in Arizona. And you can see that some of it is fibrous tissue or fibrous-like connective tissue, and some of it is kind of cellular. So basically, we got some fibrous tissue proliferation. And now let's look at an area that has these clusters. What are all of these clusters, by the way? What are these cells? These are giant cells. Now, can I ask you a question? If you are wondering whether these are foreign body giant cells, you know, rather than, you know, Langhans cells of tuberculosis, take a look at the stuff that it's surrounding. Do you see how the refractility of this compound that these foreign body giant cells are surrounding is a little bit different from your regular old collagen over here? It looks like it's foreign material. And furthermore, let's say that you were looking at this under a real microscope rather than the virtual microscope which we have, and you took your polarizing lens and you put it on this tissue. Do you think that it would twinkle a little bit more, or polarize, or birefringe more than the regular tissue? So yeah, that's another way of proving this is foreign material. So these are foreign body giant cells. Okay, now who wants to be really, really smart and tell me what this foreign material is? Somebody already said it, but I'm going to wait for three people before I reveal the answer. Somebody said CPPD. I don't think it's calcium phosphate because it looks like it has, in fact, I'm sure what it is because we see them so often. Somebody said uric acid. Well, it could be, but this is suture material. This is what happens when your sutures dissolve. Sometimes the surgeons call these stitch granulomas, okay? But this is foreign body giant cell reaction around the area in which there was surgery. And take a look at these, the perfect linearity of these refractile little fibers. This is suture material. Somebody said, could it be chitin? Well, I don't know, I guess it could be chitin if that was like a bug stinger or something like that. But it's foreign material anyway. But thanks for mentioning chitin, because now you're making me think. This is classical stitch granuloma, only because I've seen a million of them. I can't explain it. Foreign body, this is why your sutures dissolve. It's the foreign body giant cells which dissolve it. Okay, next case. Let's go to, let's go to this one. This is going to be hard and easy at the same time. First of all, the easy part is that you know it's some kind of a fibroblastic or soft tissue or connective tissue proliferation. Okay? Now I'm going to go down to this area here, which is not part of the nodular part. Oh, and I think you'll say, well, these kind of look like they're all spindly fibroblastic-like cells. Here's some that are cut longitudinally. Here's some that are cut. And I would say, well, there's an awful lot of fibroblasts there. So let's go into the part that even looks more cellular, like over here in the middle. So you see the box, by the way? You see Kansas or not? Yeah, I think you can all see Kansas. Now it's really, really cellular. And they still all look like fibroblasts, but they look like very, very atypical fibroblasts. This is probably a mitosis. This is probably a mitosis. That's probably a mitosis. That's definitely a mitosis. So you got an extreme high density of fibroblastic looking cells in which every fourth cell is a mitotic figure. Ladies and gentlemen, is this benign or malignant? Let's get down with the basics first. Yeah, you all know it's malignant. Because they still basically look fibroblastic, what is your absolute easy correct diagnosis for this case? Yeah, it's a fibrosarcoma. Half a dozen of you have said it already. So, thank you very much. I will say one more thing about the fibrosarcoma. The actual diagnosis of fibrosarcoma these days is not nearly as common as the diagnosis of malignant fibrous histiocytoma. Now, they both look the same. They both look spindly. They all generally are fibroblastic. But a lot of times you hear the word histiocyte, and that kind of complicates the issue, because I told you that a histiocyte is a macrophage, and you're probably going to think, well, these don't look like macrophages at all. They look like spindly fibroblasts. So let's make this very, very simple. When you hear the word malignant fibrous histiocytoma, or even benign fibrous histiocytoma or dermatofibroma, they're all going to look like fibroblasts. Okay, we're done. Take a quick picture. We'll move on to the next case. Here's kind of a nice one. Another soft tissue phenomenon. We could see a lot of connective tissue here. We could see some big spaces filled with blood. We could see even like a little epithelial structure over here. Can I complicate the issue and just blow up the state of Washington and say, oh, it looks like there's a little bit of glandular or ductular material here? Can I suggest that this is probably a breast lobule? Only because nothing else really in the body looks like it. So this is a breast tissue, I'll tell you that. So that's going to probably prejudice you, because you're saying, what are all these wide, big areas filled with blood and some not filled with blood doing inside of a breast? Okay, you think, oh, is this some kind of crazy breast cancer? Well, here, let's blow up Nevada over here. And in some of these little areas, you can see truly a lot of red blood cells within spaces that look like they're lined by flat endothelial cells. In most of the other areas, however, they're not big spaces. You can see blood cells within a lot of these tiny little spaces, but you're wondering, this certainly doesn't look like an epithelial tumor. It looks like a tumor in which the primary proliferation is blood-like spaces, even tiny blood-like spaces. Somebody want to venture a diagnosis? Yeah, this is a hemangioma, absolutely. Now, let's say that there weren't these big wide spaces filled with blood and you could recognize endothelial cells like you can hear and hear. Let's say this was the only part that you had, which was right here. And maybe you could see some hint of a vascular space here where you see these red blood cells. I know I blew it up too much. What stain would you do to prove that this tumor was of endothelial origin? Yeah, it's a factor VIII, because endothelial cells make factor VIII. And all of these cells now, even the ones that don't have real lumens inside of them, like maybe this one, probably have factor VIII. Okay, I don't normally like to bring in immunoperoxidase too much for basic pathology, but that's one appropriate area. It's a hemangioma of the breast. Here's another quick and easy one. Now that you have an instant understanding for tumors of blood vessels, you all recognize this as another hemangioma, is right? Correct? Just say yes or no. Instant recognition, hemangioma? Okay. But what's at the edge of this hemangioma as well? What kind of tissue is this over here? And even in the middle of it over here. So, it looks like it's a... Do these look like normal fat cells, by the way? Yes or no? Do these look like normal vascular spaces, only bigger? So, it's probably benign, and it has normal-looking fat and normal-looking blood vessels. What do you want to call it? Well, here's the lipo part, and there's the hemangioma part. So, why don't we call it a lipohemangioma? In fact, let's say that you wanted to be really smart, and you say, well, most of it is blood vessel, not much of it is fat. Let's call it a hemangiolipoma. Wouldn't that be better than lipohemangioma? Yeah, it probably would be. And really, both of them I would allow, you know? So let's take this one last area here and just show you normal-looking blood vessels. Look at that. Aren't they beautiful? And normal-looking fat. Call it a lipohemangioma. Here, look at it. Probably, if this was the area that you saw, you'd call it a lipohemangioma. But if this was the area you saw, you'd probably call it a hemangiolipoma. I don't care. And using that same kind of logic, let's move on to the next case. Here's some tissue. And what if this was histology 101? What kind of connective tissue is this? You've seen it a million times. This is regular old fat. This is mature adipose tissue. In other words, if I told the smartest pathologist world this was normal fat, they'd believe me. And if I told them it was normal looking fat, but it was kind of well encapsulated, and it kind of a nodular area, like on a perhaps a hernia sac, they'll say this is a lipoma. That's the only difference. Now, let me tell you a funny story. Let's say that you were a surgeon and you operated on somebody for a hernia, and in all honesty, the pathologist said, well, you know, I don't really see a really good example of a hernia sac. However, there is a little bit of fat here, and you normally you would just not even mention it, but you think the surgeon might come up to the pathologist and say, call it a lipoma, call it a lipoma. I don't want anybody to think I'm taking out normal fat tissue where there's no hernia present. Call it a lipoma. That's why a lot of the lipomas that you see on pathology reports are from hernia sacs. They're not true lipomas, they're just fat. I know this does not sound like a nice story, but this is the real world of medicine, folks. Are we almost done? You know what? We're done. There were three more cases, but we saw everything we wanted to see. And what I want to do now, like we said that we had been really behind in our lab, but another thing we've ever been more behind in is talking to you. So you can't see it, but I'm just popping out the attendee list here. And if any of you have microphones and they're plugged in, or if you don't have a microphone, but it's plug it in. And I'm going to look at all the raised hands now, and I want to hear some of your voices. Now, I know most people strongly prefer to chat rather than to talk. That's okay. We could look at your chat questions here, too. But I see at least one raised hand. And I'm going to tell you, about half the hands that you see that are raised, they don't realize they raised their hand, or maybe they did it by accident. But I see there's somebody here by the name of Ruth Mary. I know she's been here a lot, and I'm going to let her talk if she wants to. Hi, Ruth Mary. I know you could hear me. And if you're
going to try and embarrass me, right?
I'm going to embarrass the hell out of you, okay? How are you?
I'm fine.
We can hear you very, very well, like you're sitting here right next to me. Everybody can hear you well. How are you doing today?
Better than you. I'm in Sarasota, Florida.
Oh, God, don't tell me that. No, I'm really going to embarrass you. I hate you even more now. I know there's a medical school near there. I know there's the one in Tampa. And I know that there's another school near there as well. Are you in school?
I am. I'm actually in a nurse practitioner program.
Okay. And where is that at?
Well, right now I'm in the process of transferring over to University of Florida.
Okay, cool. Well, what do you want to say? I'm all ears now. I promise not to embarrass you anymore.
Oh, I don't know. The only thing I would ever ask is, I know most of your students probably get all the answers right, but I have a tendency to wait for you to say the answer, and you go,
that's
right,
okay.
That's right. And I'm
It would be nice if the students can see all the other students' responses, but unfortunately, that's not built into the software. And I've actually called the webinar people and bitched at them about that, but they never listened to any of my suggestions. You know, they listened to the suggestions of their CEOs and their attorneys, not for real users. But you know, Sarasota is really, really beautiful, beautiful area. I've been through there many times. Is it Longboat Key that goes along the Gulf over there?
That's correct.
Oh,
right.
God. Does this help you for your curriculum?
Absolutely, because we read a lot, and this kind of reinforces the real life part of it for me. So even when I go into practice, I can look at things and all of a sudden I hear your voice screaming in the back of my head, if it's not this, automatically this, you know? And then I remember, and like a few of the physicians I work with have kind of turned and looked at me and said, how do you know that, you know? So.
Well, you want to know the funny thing, even though you couldn't see the responses before I said them, when I was in Puerto Rico, all of the students in the auditorium could see their responses. So when I would walk up to one of the iguanas and start screaming at them and embarrassing them and asking them, demanding a question, they always looked at to what the buzzards were saying first. So that is how you helped the iguanas. So I want to thank you for that, and I want to also thank you for remembering the big time change. I was afraid nobody would show up because it's a massively different time, but there's still a good number over here. So, Ruth
this
Mary,
is actually better for me, so.
I want you to rock on and have a great time there in Florida.
You too.
Thank you for talking. I'm going to take some of the chat questions now. And one of them is, somebody has really bad internet. For some reason, there's somebody who I know personally. His name is Mario Vella. He's a great diver. He dove into a river from a waterfall in El Yunque. He's having a hard time hearing me, although the rest of them can. So, yes, Mario, I'm going to be uploading the movies as soon as this is over. In a couple hours, you could download them. And thanks for showing up. And Mario, you could at least respond to this question. Do you feel more like a buzzard today, or do you feel more like an iguana? And his answer is both. Okay. Oh, and by the way, when I come back there next year, do you promise to dive into that same river that you dove into before? And his answer is, he doesn't want to answer. Okay, well, maybe he's thinking about it. Oh, that's right. And when you do download my lectures, rather than attend them live, you can see what the responses are. That's the good news. The bad news is, you're not seeing it real time anymore. So that's one way you could get the responses. But usually, when I see a bunch of correct responses, I repeat them verbally as well. So thanks for reminding of that, Dan. And, I can see I'm swishing through the hundreds of responses from today. And if nobody else wants to make a response, I'm going to see that it's only 2 minutes before the end of the hour, so this is a good time to not only play the closing song for the Buzzards, but I'm also going to give you the lyrics over here. And for those of you that are old enough to remember from the 80s, REO Speedwagon, this is their signature song. See you in 46 hours, Buzzards. And we'll close off with, I can't fight this feeling any longer.
Baby.
maybe I can't fight this feeling anymore. Rock on, you buzzards.